And welcome back, everybody, to the 8th episode of Season 1 Everything Horror Podcast. I am your host, Paul Dosky, joined by my co-host, Tessa, and wait for it, everybody, but we have another special guest-ish, which I will get to a special announcement after this drum roll, because it's very... Oh, yes. That's right. A drum roll. For the new co-host, Chrystello, a.k.a. Chrystello Lovebello from Twitch. She is no longer... Which she is no longer considered a guest. Because she's been on here way too much to not even be called a guest anymore.
She's joined the inner circle.
She has joined the inner circle of becoming the next co-host.
Inner Sanctum. There we go.
Yeah, So...
I feel so honored.
You should be.
Yeah. Yeah, you should be. You've been on almost every one of our podcasts.
Except for maybe three or four now.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, last episode, you hosted it to interview us, so... It was a nice little turnabout.
Yeah, but it was a nice little,
Change.
Yeah, it was a nice way to break her in.
Yeah.
See how she, you know,
how she can do it. Yeah. But she did well. She did awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, I enjoyed it.
I was always nervous. I almost sound like a doof when I did it. But.
No, you did great.
Yeah, you did awesome.
Oh, we're very proud of you.
Yep. I would just want...
Yay!
Yay! I didn't even tell Tessa this at all. I was just thinking of it.
Well, if you weren't going to do it, I was going to recommend it.
Well, then, see what happens when you have two great minds. Anyway, since Crypto, the new co-host here, Crypto, can you please tell the listeners what tonight's topic is called?
Tonight's topic is called The Witch, which is a really good movie we're going to talk about and discuss.
Right. Yeah, so tonight's episode is called The Witch, Evil Takes Many Forms. I kind of, as you can see from the image when you do see this podcast up, that I kind of just used the image that already had Evil Take Many Forms and kind of just switched the image around a little bit. But we got some nice little surprises coming up, too. So, let me ask you guys this. When The Witch first came out, what were you guys thought on The Witch, like, when you first heard about it? Like, were you wanting to see it? Were you skeptical about it? Let's hear your thoughts. Crystal, let's start with you.
Well, I had no idea about it until we did the Sounds of Horror, the Musical Horror Podcast, when we were listening to different soundtracks from films and games, and you're the one that told me about it. You're like, which the soundtrack was freaking awesome. You're like, you need to watch this movie. It's really good. It's really good. And so, like, I was like, alright, I'll watch it. And I planned on watching it eventually. And then you're like, we're going to do a podcast on it. Watch it. So I was like, alright. That's why I watched it. That's how I found out about it.
Nice. Tessa? When you are done chewing up the nom 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 food.
My first thoughts on it when I heard about it, which I had seen like little previews of it here and there on Facebook, and I wasn't quite sure what to think of it. And my first time ever watching it was actually with you. And
yeah, I brought it over back when we first kind of started dating because I think I mentioned something like, hey, you ever seen The Witch or something? And you're like, no. And I'm like, really?
You were just kind of, you did one of those.
Like, really?
Like, you just pretty much gave me like the how darest you look.
Pretty much.
Anyways, yeah, he brought it over to my house one night when I was still living in New York.
Well, one weekend, to be technical.
Yeah, one weekend when I was still living in New York, and we this is like you said at the beginning of when we were dating, and I was sitting there and I was watching it, and the music alone was just like, wow, like the soundtrack, it just grabbed you and it sucked you in, and I was like, ooh, and like. Just the whole movie just pretty much had me engrossed, because it's like, if you, like, walked away from it, or, like, stopped watching it for, like, a few moments, you'd, like, miss, like, something really good happening, like, I don't want to give too much away, because we're going to get into it, but, it was really intense. But it had this way of just, like, sucking you in. And, like, entrancing you, almost bewitching you in a way. And, I just really love that because, like, it's been a long time since I've actually seen a movie about witches or the concept of them.
Of a covenant.
Yeah. Of a covenant that actually did justice. Like,
Even when we watched the behind the scenes, which Crystal, unfortunately, I don't think would have seen it yet until she gets the DVD, but when we were watching, like, even the questions and answers with Robert Eggers and the cast.
Anya.
Yeah, Anya. Who played as
Thomason, yeah.
They were also greeted with three historical...
historians.
Historian from Salem. Which they even said that this movie blew their minds because they've seen other projects come and go, but others kind of, like, failed the idea from what I remember one of them saying. Like, they just, like, didn't really portray the witch as it should. And then as Robert Eggers came, they even were saying, like, who were you talking to? To give you, like, this incredible information about it and stuff to be, like, spot on for, like, the 1600s. So, it was actually a nice little, it definitely is a nice little mood. I remember watching the first trailer, and I'm just like, I'm gonna love this film.
I also want to mention one more thing about it that I really loved before we get into the actual film. I love the symbolism that they used. Of certain things that you would see in this movie, they use different animals and different... what's the word I'm looking for? Well, symbolism. And they used it actually very well. And if you actually know a lot about witches, this movie will actually make a lot more sense to you because you'll understand the symbolism and things like that. Their way of doing,
that they're witches among us.
Yeah, witches among us type of...
Well, Robert Eggers did say, that they took, like, real stories, real journals, real records.
Real life events, things like that. Truth, factual things.
Yeah, mixed with fairy tale stories.
Yep.
To help bring it to life. But, so, soundtrack-wise, yeah, so, Crystal, when you were watching the movie, since you haven't actually heard all the soundtrack, really, until you kind of watched the movie, but... In your words, how did you like the soundtrack?
I loved it. Like, the soundtrack really set the mood for that movie. Like, it just drew you in. Like, just the different tones to it. Like, when the music, when Sam gets taken, when a witch takes Sam, you know, even to the point at the very end, where I'm not going to say nothing, but, you guys know at the end where she's walking. I mean, it's just, the music pulls you in. It's got such suspense to it that it kind of just leaves you, like Seth said, you don't want to get up from it. Not only did the acting, like, was phenomenal, but music really, really set the tone for that movie. So, it was really good actually getting to hear the soundtrack being played out through the film and getting to watch the different scenes that the music goes to.
Yeah, I agree. Mark Corvin, if that's how you pronounce his name, he's the composer that made the soundtrack, actually. So, if anybody wants the soundtrack, go on Amazon. It's like $9. So, it's not that bad of a deal. And there's like 15 tracks on it. 15, 16 tracks. It's definitely worth it, especially if you enjoyed the movie as much as I did. So let's begin. So, The Witch was a 2015 movie that got released on February 19, 2016, and then later released on DVD in May. May 6th, I believe, somewhere around that neighborhood. It was actually nominated for 55 awards, and the film won 27 awards out of the 55. The budget was like $3 million to make the film, and through the box office, they made $40.5 million.
That's impressive.
Dang, that is.
And I don't know if you guys actually noticed or seen anything, but like when the movie came out, I love the movie so much that I kind of was curious to see how people reacted to such a historian type film, is the way I look at it. And, because it wasn't really out there, the movie itself wasn't there to just spook you, like, you know, give you jump scares and stuff. It was there to pretty much show you, like, the life of a struggling family back in the 1630s. That were banished from their town because apparently the
William,
father...
William. He was too full of pride to
give in to the false belief
yeah.
of Christianity because he thought people there were fake Christians. So they got banished from the town. And I don't know if you guys actually caught on, but the governor was actually Julian Richens. I said his name right. He's actually the guy, the actor who plays in Supernatural TV series as Death. So I don't know if you guys knew that.
I didn't know that.
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, if you actually look very closely, you can literally tell it's him underneath the mustache and beard. Right at the very beginning. Another thing that I found interesting, which I didn't actually notice, and it's kind of weird because I watched it, not recently, but I did watch the movie with you, but Prometheus.
Mm-hmm.
The lady who played Catherine, Kate something, I can't remember her last name right now. It's Kate something. Ironic, though, her character's name was Catherine.
Mm-hmm.
But, Kate was actually in Prometheus. As Ford.
Yeah. I do remember her in Prometheus.
I forgot about that.
Remember in Prometheus.
She played as Ford in Prometheus. Which I'm trying to remember that too. Yeah, I'm trying to remember that too. But yeah, that's another topic later on. But So they got banished because William had a lot of pride. So they set out on their two-wheel wagon with a horse to discover a plot of land. And as you guys saw it with the eerie music from Banish music, they found their plot of land. And then they got on their knees and pretty much prayed and was like, kind of like thanking to God for this plot of land. And then like a few months down the road... You see their nice little settlement that they've made.
Did you mention what time period this is supposed to be in?
1630s.
Yep. 1630s New England.
Yeah. So, So, yeah, so you got to see their new settlement that got built within, like, I don't know, maybe a year or so. It didn't really say how long it really took, but we'll just say a year, just for shits and giggles. But one thing that you kind of notice right away is that William is trying to teach Caleb, the boy, how to hunt, how to take care of the animals, and how to crop food, like corn-wise and stuff, like getting ready to harvest that, so that way when the winter comes, they'll be able to hunt for their food, because corn and stuff won't grow, so they gotta find another way to eat. So, let's talk about the family. So, the family is made up of William, who is the husband, Catherine, who is the wife, you got Thomasine, who is the oldest daughter, you got Caleb, who is the oldest son, you got Mercy and Jonas, who are known as the twins, one is the youngest daughter, and the other is the youngest son, and then you got Sam, the newborn. So, who would like to discuss that, about right before Sam got away?
So, Catherine asks Thomasine to take Sam and go outside with him, I guess, and she takes him out, so Thomasine takes Sam out to the, out to the tree line, we'll just say. And she's, she lays him on the ground on his little red blanket, and she's playing peekaboo with him. And, she goes to go, you know, peekaboo and take her hands away from her eyes, and he's gone. Gone. Like, no signs of struggle, like, no sounds whatsoever made. Just gone.
So, Crypto, then what happens?
So, after Sam gets taken, like, the mother just gets, like, distraught. Catherine just gets, like, you know, she doesn't want to get out of bed, she's crying, she's weeping, and it, Thomasine is trying to take care of the twins and watch the twins from the mother, while Caleb and William have been searching for Sam. They all think that Sam has been taken by a wolf, which I believe, if I'm not mistaken, at one point they talk about how if it was a wolf that had attacked him, the wolf would attack, you know, attack again, but it hadn't.
Yep.
So the family starts to kind of go into shambles a little bit after Sam was taken. They're all kind of on edge and frayed. And the young twins actually start talking about a witch has taken Sam. And which that leads into a whole other mess of problems. I don't want to go too far. And poor Sam, the baby, actually gets killed in a sacrifice with the witch.
Yeah.
You see a scene where the babe is naked, and the witch, you don't see her kill the baby, but you see her touch on the baby, and then her grinding something up and a big stone, and she's rubbing this bloody pulp all over her.
Which I'm assuming.
You kind of have an idea.
It's a mortal and pestle, which is used to grind up herbs and other ingredients that they would use for their craft. She made this pulp, which was supposed to be a flying anointment oil or balm, for lack of a better word, that was to make her fly, essentially, and she rubbed it all over her broom, too, to kind of, like, bless it. And she's seen riding off into the sky on the broom.
Yep. So then after William and Caleb, well, especially William, decided that they need to stop the search because it's just been too long. They haven't been able to find Sam, so they figured that if the wolf hadn't taken him, then the hunger would have gotten to Sam by now. But I just, before I get too far, too, since we're on the topic of the witch taking Sam, but what are your guys' thoughts on how you think the witch took Sam?
Like how she took Sam right out from underneath yes. Thomason's nose?
Yes. What do you guys think of that? Or what are your guys' theory, I should say? Like, you think, like, she, like, did, like, a disappearing act type thing? Or you think that she kind of teleported him? What do you guys think?
It could have, honestly, it could have gone either way. She could have done, like, a spell to, like, I don't know, like, call him to her, like, manifest him. She could have done something like, she could have just, you know, gone up, like, snuck in, like, real quick while, you know, Thomason's eyes were covered and just snatched them and then went poof. I mean, there's quite a few things that could have happened for, you know, her way of how she could have taken them. That's just the thing about the movie. You don't, it doesn't really show you. You don't really know. So it leaves you to wonder, like, how did she get him that quick without Thomason noticing? No, you know, no sounds, no crying, no nothing, and just vanished with him. Because I was even curious as to how she actually got him, and I had that thought rolling through my mind. What about you, Crystal?
Well, it really shocked me because, I mean, and I'm not going to lie, I don't know, like, a lot about, like, real witchcraft and things like that. I mean, I know some, but not a lot. Like, my whole thing was maybe she had maybe bewitched Thomason to where, you know, she couldn't hear it coming up, or made it to where, see, it sounds crazy, but, like, making time stand still, so when, like, she had her eyes covered, the witch could have came, snagged the baby, and when she left, time restarted again, you know? So, I mean, I thought maybe she may have somehow, like, bewitched her to where she just didn't see her, or, like y'all said, she teleported real quick, and then got back to the tree line and ran off. Because Thomason does see the trees move when she's looking for Sam. Okay. So, it was really strange. Like, I was like, that's really quick. She was sneaky about it, I know that.
Yes. Yeah, I keep picking my brain on that part, too, just because I keep wanting to think how the witch could have done it, but of course, I know with most stories, they don't really tell you at all, like, how they do it. So, you just kind of, I kind of like that idea, too, because it makes up your own theory. Like, well, maybe she flew in on her broom and carried him away that way, but then you would have heard crying. So, then it kind of goes with, like, what you guys said, kind of like, bewitched, maybe time stopped for a minute so she could snatch him and then, like, restarted the time or something. I mean, I don't know. It's hard to really tell. But yeah, we'll carry on now. So William, at this point in time, after they stopped searching, William is trying to teach Caleb how to trap and shoot. So, you know, they're in the woods, which later on you're going to find out that Catherine didn't even want Caleb in the woods. Yada, 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 because she's afraid that he's gonna also be bewitched and everything else, but, you know, they come across some trap where the bait is gone and nothing catch, and then they're finally about ready to go home, and then their dog, Fowler, starts barking, and you know, William just like, what is it? And then they see the rabbit, the hare, in the woods. William, you know, get prepared like any hunter would to take the shot. But this is also the 1630s, so you gotta actually put rope at the end of the gun and light it. So it took some time, but during that time, you know, the rabbit just calm, and then William goes to shoot. Completely, like...
The gun backfires.
Backfires. And the hare just kind of goes away like nothing ever happened. So I guess my question is, what did you guys think of that part? With the whole, like, William having a backfire of the gun and this mysterious hare in the woods.
I just felt like bad misfortune for him at first until, you know, the hare shows up later on in the film.
When Thomasine is trying to bed it in the goat and you see the hare again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I didn't think too much about the hare at first. I thought, well, this, you know, these people are just having really bad luck. This dude's gun backfired on them. They're just having a shitty time right now. I mean, it was kind of weird that the rabbit stood there just that calm. Like, it wasn't even scared of the dog. Like, normal rabbits, yeah, they get, like, they lock up, but that rabbit was just like, hey, I'm a rabbit. What's going on? So it just kind of hung out there and wasn't really scared of him. So, but, like, when I saw it the second time, I was like, okay, I had my ideas of what the hare was, but I don't know if I'm right or not, but I think I knew what the hare was. I don't think it was actually a rabbit, but that way.
Yeah, I came to the conclusion that it's not a rabbit. It has some
it's familiar. It's a hare, a familiar. Certain animals are depicted as witches' familiars. Black cats, rats, snakes, hares, whatever. So.
How about ravens and what was the other one?
Ravens, wolves,
and I don't think goats would be one. I don't think goats would be one. Goats wouldn't be one, right?
Goats are capable of being one, yes.
Well, in this case, it's not, but we'll get to that in a minute.
Goat is more or less a depiction of something else.
Yes.
We're going to get to.
Yes. But yeah, I mean, I remember seeing the movie at first in theaters, and I just noticed this strange hair, and I'm just like, kind of like what Crypto was saying, like, he is completely calm with this dog barking at him. And then when the gun misfired, I kind of went, ah, tricky, tricky. Just because I kind of figured, like, this hare had, like, some sort of protection spell. So, like, if somebody were to try to shoot it, it's going to backfire, which it kind of did with Williams. So, it would be interesting if something along the lines of that was the case. But, yeah, so, you know, we'll talk about the weird-ass stuff that goes on when Thomasine and Caleb are told to kind of go wash the clothes. Even before then, like, you kind of notice there's something weird going on between Caleb and Thomasine.
I noticed throughout different points of the movie, you would catch Caleb looking at Thomasine, like, in a way that a brother shouldn't look at his sister, let's just say. Like, he was watching her sleep, noticed that part of her cleavage of her breast was showing, he was staring. Another time, what was it, down by,
the
brook, she's sitting on the ground, her dress is hiked up, you can see, like, her stockings and stuff, and her dress is, like, loosened up at the top, so you can see her cleavage again, and he's staring again. Obviously, like I said, not in a way a brother should look at his sister. So, like...
Mike, what are your thoughts on that? Like, why do you think Caleb would be looking at his sister like that, I guess? Like, why would you think a kid would do that?
I don't know why a kid would do that. I know why a boy would do that, because it's like human nature. Like, they pretty much all got banished from town. And they're all out in, like, the middle of, like, Booniesville, for lack of a better word. And, you know, Thomason's coming into age, you know, she's blooming or whatever. And her brother is noticing, and it's not a good kind of notice. I don't think it should be a way that you should look at, like, your sister, you know, just like I wouldn't want, like, a sister to look at her brother that way kind of deal. It's just something you just don't do. But it did happen in this movie, and it happened quite frequently, and, it's just one of those things that I was just kind of like, I was like, is he really looking at her like that? I mean, that's like how you look at me, babe, sometimes.
Oh, thanks.
No, I don't mean like a brother would to a sister. I mean, mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. I'll just remember that later.
No, I'm saying like the way that Caleb looks at Thomason is the way that you would like expect like a boyfriend or a girlfriend or a husband and a wife to look at each other. Not like a brother and a sister to look at each other. That's what I mean.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Anyway, Crystal, what were your thoughts when you first noticed that Caleb was, like, staring at Thomasine?
It's one of the awkward situations. Like, I was, like, sitting there eating ramen, and I was like, is he really staring at her cleavage? Thinking wrong, when I was like, no. He's actually watching her sleep, like, eyeballing her like that, and I'm like, okay, this is just a little weird. And I was like, maybe it's just a one-time thing. And then down at the creek, it happened again. I'm like, you know, back in the day, I mean, there was a lot of, you know, inbreeding, I guess. Especially if they moved out further from other people. And I guess, like you said, she's come of age, she's blooming, you know. And she's the only other female that there's to look at besides his mom. So I was just like, you know, and the thing is, she didn't say anything about it to him. She just let him stare at her like that. If, you know, my little brother decided to stare at me like that, I'd be like, hey, what the hell is wrong with you? You know, watch your eyes. But she was okay with it. I know when she was asleep, she couldn't do nothing, but when she was awake, you know, she didn't try to reprimand her from staring at her like that.
No, but so she did try to make him try to say it, though. As you kind of noticed at the pond area, she was, like, trying to get him to say, like, what's wrong, like, what is he, like, you know, looking at kind of thing, but he just kind of was shrugged and carried on, but she should have said something. I agree, but I think she was trying to make him say it. So.
And like Crystal says, like, back then in that time period, there was, you know, a lot of probably, you know, inbreeding or whatever, you know, brothers and sisters, cousins, you know, old, like, daughters, you know, and older men, and all sorts of other things, you know, younger, younger women marrying older men and stuff like that, and family members. So, you know, I can understand where Crystal's coming from in this, but still, no.
It's not right.
Just no. No. No.
So, we're at the part now where Crystal was kind of mentioning about the twins mentioning something about the witch, seeing the witch. So, Crystal, since you were saying something about that, we'll give you the mic now about the twins talking about the witch in the wood.
Well, first of all, the twins are brats. Oh, my God. They're on my nerves in the movie. Oh, man. I felt bad from the beginning, but they were brats throughout the whole movie.
Oh,
but,
God, yeah.
Mercy, the youngest daughter, Caleb and Thomason are at the creek washing their dad's clothes. Mercy's over there, and well, I'm the witch of the woods, you know, I'm the witch of the woods, I'm going to get my broom of fly and come get you. She's just taunting Thomason about a witch. And Thompson tries to reprimand her and tell her, you know, stop talking like that, you know, and that's when Mercy says something about a witch taking Sam. And then she accuses Thomason of being a witch, to which Thomason gets fed up with it and actually plays along, saying,
I'm the witch of the woods.
And
I signed
she goes
a book
and proceeds,
and blah, 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 and yeah. Yeah.
Then she proceeds to go attack Mercy, you know, and Caleb tries to break it up. She does feel bad about it and tells Mercy not to say anything about it to their mother. But Mercy ends up running back home, and then she ends up telling Caleb to leave her alone and to go tell her parents of her wickedness that she has done, you know, feeding into what her sister was saying to her. So that's when you start seeing, that's really when the family, I mean, even when Sam got taken away, the family was starting to kind of crumble. But after this is really where it starts to fall into shambles, after she admits to being the witch and all that.
Yeah, that pretty much sums up that part. But yeah, since you kind of went on about that, I just figured that should be what you could talk about since you were starting to go that route. So the next part, which I kind of wrote this down just because, it just felt like it was around the time, even though you kind of learn about one thing later on, but, they're at dinner and at first, you know, they do their prayer and stuff, and then later on, all four of the kids, the twins, Catherine, and Caleb, are still awake, too. And, you know, the mother is crying over the fact that Sam had been sent to hell, and William trying to say that, no, he went to heaven, and everything else. And then it gets to the talk about Catherine is around, getting to the point to be sold to be a slave, pretty much. Just like every kid there, Caleb and the twin, when they get older, they're going to be sold as slaves so the mother and father can stay on the farm and carry on with their lives. During
number one parents right there.
Yeah. During the dinner, though, Catherine does ask about her silver cup, which, at this point in time, you kind of knew what happened, because if you guys remember the part with, when William was with Caleb in the woods, he told Caleb that, hey, look, your mother doesn't know this yet, but I'm trying to figure out a perfect time to say this, but I sold your mother's father's silver cup for food. So, the Caleb, you know, promises not to say anything and stuff, and then during that dinner time, you know, it's almost like Catherine is trying to gain up on Catherine, because
gang up on Thomason.
Or Thomason, I mean. And that's when William finally cuts in and said, hey, you know, we'll worry about it later, kind of thing. But I just wanted to throw that out there. But you also start to notice, like, the food is starting to become rotten right before the goat's milk turns to blood. But the goat milk thing turning to blood, that's a little bit later on, but I just remembered that and I just jotted it down. But yeah, you kind of start to see their family right here even kind of start falling apart. And you can just see everything around them is starting to decay. And you kind of notice their face is starting to get lost, too. So they were also when they were talking about getting rid of the children to different families, they were mentioning two family names, the Tildens and the Wythings, or Waythings, however you pronounce that one, which I thought was interesting. Because apparently they knew them because they were, like, friends with them or something. But I just thought that was interesting and weird at the same time. So, Tessa, we're gonna have you talk about this part. So, and then if you want, Crystal can help. But this is the part now when Caleb decides to wake up early to try to start hunting. So he wanted to be back before dawn to help, enlighten the mood, I guess we'll say.
Okay, so Caleb goes and sneaks out to the barn and preps the horse to set out to go out into the woods to hunt. But Thomason discovers him out in the barn trying to leave. And proceeds to, you know, pick his brain, be like, well, where are you going? You know, tell me or else I'll wake mother and father. She threatens him. She's like, tell me or I will wake them, you know, and you have to take me with you or I will wake them. And, he gives in and he lets Thomason come along and they go into the woods and they're checking traps for food and picking up rabbits and stuff, and they come across the infamous hare that was spoken of earlier when Caleb and William were in the woods and William tried to shoot on the hare and it backfired. So this is the same hare, and Fowler goes chasing after the hare, and the hare, before it bolts off, the horse that Thomason is sitting on is spooked by this hare and freaked out by it. And so the horse starts going crazy, and Fowler goes running off after the hare, and Caleb goes running off after Fowler, and Thomason falls off the horse, and she's knocked unconscious. Caleb's looking for Fowler and discovers Fowler by hearing his whines and his whimpering, and discovers that Fowler's ripped open, and you can see his guts and organs and all that lovely stuff. And
which I think Crystal had something to say about that part.
Poor Fowler, that poor puppy. That was, like, one of the worst parts of the movie was when I saw the poor puppy, like, gutted. I was like, no, not the dog. Anyone but the dog.
It's like, what did the dog do to you?
Yeah, that poor thing. He was just doing his job. You didn't have to kill him. You could have let him go.
So
just sent him home.
So, Caleb Caleb, after discovering Fowler, Caleb proceeds to start calling out for Thomason because he's obviously lost and he can't find his way back to Thomason, which Thomason is knocked unconscious at this point and cannot answer Caleb. So Caleb's wandering through the woods and, you know, all, like, petrified and everything, which I would expect because he's a kid lost in, you know, lost in the woods. And he happens upon the moss-covered hobbit of the witch, which has smoke coming out of the chimney and everything else. And then as you're watching the front door of this hobbit, it slowly starts to open until, like, this really beautiful woman emerges. And she just, like, she's just radiating, like, this, like, sexual energy. And it's, like, almost, like, flirtatious. Like, she's, like, got, like, the come hither look to her. And, she's got her, you know, her breasts all propped up and everything, exposing a little leg, you know. And this, and Caleb's just standing there, like,
Drawn to her,
but also terrified at the same time. It's like he's so, like, scared of her, but he's just so, like, he's being, like, sucked in. And, like, he goes right up to her, and she reaches out for him, and she grabs a hold of his face, and she kisses him on the lips. And then all you see is, like, this, like, old, like, hag arm just grab a hold of him.
From behind,
and after that, he disappears.
Yeah. So, do you remember what happens when Thomason finally wakes up and William is searching for Caleb and Thomason? Do you remember that part?
I'm trying to think. I know when Thomason wakes up, she's by herself.
Yep.
And I know she goes looking for Caleb. She's, you know, and she's searching the woods, I think, and I know she hears William yell for her. And yep. She goes running back. She's like she was closer to the front of the forest for some reason, because it wasn't that far that she had to run before she was running back through the valley back to her dad.
Yep.
Oh.
Yeah, so then William catches up with Thomasine, and Thomasine brings her back to the house. And that's when, like, you know, Catherine is trying to figure out why she went into the woods with Caleb, and Thomasine won't promise not to say anything. And, you know,
she brings up the cup again or something, and that's when William admits that he stole the cup.
Well,
because I remember she asked Catherine about being in her favor or something like that.
She's like, I want to find, she's like, let me find favor in your eyes.
If you want me to believe in you, yeah, let me find favor in your eyes. And then she does bring up the cup because to Catherine, she's like, the last one to actually see the cup, according to Catherine. But William now speaks up and says, no, I actually sold it. And that kind of, like, make Catherine rethink things, like, what the hell's going on here, kind of thing. And,
she decks William in the face.
Yes, she
socks him super good.
Yep.
Well, she's irate, pissed off by this point. So, I mean, I don't blame her.
Oh yeah, she's had enough. I don't either. I would have probably decked somebody too.
Yep. And then during the this is the kind of one part that I found kind of weird. But during this next scene, like, it's almost bedtime, and Right, this is right before, they go to sleep for the night, even though they kind of don't want to look for Caleb. Well, William does. William wants to go, so he's trying to actually go back to the town. He's trying to find anything that's worth taking to try to bring people back with him to start looking for Caleb and this witch and wolf or whatever the next day. Which, if you guys notice, right at this whole time, you notice that Catherine is treating Thomasine, like, almost kind of bad. Like, almost like a slave. Like, not even like a daughter. And then, this point in time, after William admits selling the cup, it kind of, like, releases some stress, I should say. Because Thomasine then asks Catherine if she can go and bed the goats. Which Catherine's like, come here. And then, like, you know, like, thank you kind of thing. And then Thomasine goes off to bed the goat. Which, in this case, does Chrystello remember this part? When Thomasine goes to bed the goat this time?
Is this when they talk to Black Phillip? The twins are telling her that Black Phillip calls her a witch?
Not yet. But this is the part where, as she's outside, she sees the hair in the thing, but then she also stumbles upon Caleb.
You know, for some reason, I got up, and I missed the part. Like, when I came back, I think I went to put my cup in the sink. I didn't see the part where they found Caleb. I just saw that, like, when they brought him into the house. I think I turned, and that's what they were saying earlier. If you get up and you don't watch the whole movie, you're going to miss something. Like, I didn't see when they found Caleb. I just saw they brought Caleb into the house.
Yeah, okay, so
I was like, where the hell did Caleb come from?
Okay, yeah, so Tetra will tell you what happened then.
So, Thomason's in, and she's soothing the goats, trying to get them to sleep, and then, like Paul says, she notices the hair. She goes outside to investigate, and she finds Caleb, completely bucket-ass naked, shivering and soaking wet from the rain, and completely, like, delusional and hysterics, like, out of his fucking mind. And he collapses in Thomason's arms, and she starts calling out for her parents, you know, help me, you know. He's here, blah, blah, blah. And they take him. That's where they come out, and they take him in the house, and they take him up to the attic, or as it seems to be known, the kids' room or whatever.
Yeah, and this is, I'm assuming daylight, unless,
it's nighttime. It was nighttime.
Still, I know that, but I mean,
up in the attic, I think it was daytime, because yeah, there was light in the window.
So, Crystal should know this part then. Since she mentioned Cablewood back.
So, at this point, like, you're talking about him being sick, and, they actually, I guess back in the day, to, like, get a fever or illness, they would, you know, use leeches and things like that, so they actually slice the side of his head to, drain the blood, because, like I said, they think he's ill. There's nothing wrong with him. So, they're draining, you know, trying to, help Caleb, but, while Caleb's in the attic, like I was saying earlier, Black Phillip is the goat.
Yep.
That,
the twins keep talking, yeah.
Talking to Black Phillip.
Yep.
So, Thomas and the twins are actually in the goat pen, and Thompson's trying to milk the female goat, and the twins, Mercy and Jonas, you know, tell him that we've been talking to Black Phillip, and he says that you're a witch. You've bewitched Caleb. And, you know, of course she's denying it and stuff, and the kids are saying that the parents are going to find out eventually that she's a witch. And as she tries to milk the goats, blood shoots out. And she squeezes again and more blood shoots out. And Thomasin kicks the bucket over, terrified. And the twins are just staring at her, you know, confused as to why she kicked the bucket over. And as she kicks it over, you see the blood kind of pouring out of the bucket that she was trying to milk the goat with.
Yep. So then that kind of leads into when they go up to try to take care of Caleb after he was found that night. You know, Caleb is all tucked in. He's got his head drained a little bit so he could, like, possibly get... I'm assuming they did that so they could get some of the, like, delusional poison shit out of him kind of thing. I forget the technical wording of that, but, it's kind of like, if your head feels swollen, it's almost like you cut your head on that to release some of the swollen kind of thing. So, I'm assuming that's, like, what they did, were doing with Caleb. But, so at this point in time, Caleb is back home, up in the kids' attic of their room, and he is spazzing really, really bad from violent seizures. And at this point in time, Catherine is trying to figure out what's going on, and then she finally has the conclusion that it's got to be witchcraft, and she starts praying. I don't know if you guys, and you guys want to take over this part about Caleb's demise, but you guys are more than welcome to.
So, they all, like, they start praying, and during it, the twins start to fade out of prayer, and the mother and Thomasin are trying to get after the twins, you know, pray, need to pray, and the twins are like,
I forgot
my prayer. I forgot how to pray, you know. And then they start, like, screaming and saying, you know, like freaking out and, like, flailing to the ground and, like, kicking their feet, like
crazy.
Like,
this is all Thomason's fault because Thomason just, like, tucked them, too, kind of thing.
Yeah. So they're like, stop it. Please stop. And all the while, Caleb is starting to... is, like, screaming and...
Then he becomes silent.
And then he becomes eerily silent.
Because his mother, Catherine, starts to notice that his mouth has been, like, shut.
Like it's sealed shut.
Yeah. Which Crypto should know this part. We'll take the story to her now.
So, they actually, start trying to pry his jaws open with a knife. And I think they eventually do. They get his mouth open. And then poor Caleb starts agonizing about his guts. His guts, you know, his innards and stuff. And he starts puking up something. Something's coming out of his mouth. And it's an apple. Which, at one point in the film, Caleb tells his mother a lie about why they went to the woods while with his dad, that he saw apple trees. And lo and behold, what he keeps up is a rotten apple.
With one bite taken out of it.
And then he kind of lays back, and I think he starts screaming a few more things about the good Lord kiss me on my lips or something.
Before that, he kind of starts saying something about, like, a broad axe to her head, and then, like, an axe to her head, and then a broad axe to her head, and then an axe to the head. And then, as you were saying, then he finally, like, he's almost like heaven's light is, like, hitting his body or something. And then he starts saying, my Lord, kiss me with the lips and, send me up to thy light and stuff like that.
Send me up to thy lap.
Yeah.
And then Caleb is no more. That was his last words.
He pretty much just, he does like slowly go back to his laying position though before he finally takes his last breath though.
Yeah.
But yeah. Poor Caleb.
You guys feel bad for him, like that poor kid. I felt so bad for him. Like he just was trying to do right. Even with his like ancestral fantasies, I guess.
Yeah. And then after Caleb's death, William, or is it, this is before they even start praying, but William, like, bring Thomason aside and says, get down on your knees, because he didn't raise, like, a witch in the family. And she has to look at William in the eye while confessing, like, she is not a witch, she's not bewitching, and, like, everything else, which she all said, yes, she's not a witch and all that stuff. But at the very end...
confess!
Yeah. And then at the very end, when Caleb finally died, that's when William kind of loses his shit. Because the next thing that happened is he takes... After Thomason revealed that the twins had been chatting with Black Phillip and stuff like that, that's when William finally decides, like, okay, enough is enough. So, he brings Thomasine outside to chat with her about how the farm's gonna be in, like, another year with, like, a milk cow, this tree that, had gotten bigger since they arrived, and then, like, you know, William once again asked Thomasine about the truth, like, because... William was going to go back the next day to go against the judge, and he was going to say something about the whole witch in the wood thing. But then the twins got mentioned again about talking to Black Phillip, which is the black goat, on their farm, which pretty much after... Thomasine tells William what's been going on. That's when William brings Thomasine in, where Catherine is now trying to work on their Caleb's dead body to get it ready for burial. And the twins are pretty much, like, out cold or something, like, laying on a bed. And then that's when William is trying to get Thomasine to tell Catherine what she told him outside, which is that the twins have been talking to Black Phillip. And at this point in time, William is getting more angry to the point where, like, he wants the twins to wake up because he wants to know if the twins made a deal with the goat to be bewitching the farm. Which leads to something else, if anybody wants to take over this. After finally the twins wake up, and Thomasine is still there, something else happened. This is when William is angry. Because this is the part where it's going to start getting ready to, where William is going to go the next day to get help and, like, bring Catherine to be bought, just like the twins were going to be bought off, from what I got.
I know he puts the kids and Thomason in the goat pen and boards them up in there.
Yes.
I do know that. I mean,
yeah, that's the part I'm talking about. Yep.
You're getting that?
Yep. Yep. So, later that night, which, you know, at this point in time, Thomasine is trying to ask if the twins are saying, if Black Phillip is saying anything to them, which it doesn't seem like it. In this point, you can actually kind of see, like, the goat itself is just, like, just chilling there, relaxing, like, like, yeah, like, yeah. But then...
I'm a goat, that's nothing else.
Yeah, I'm a goat, nothing else, nothing to see here. And then, so Crystal, what happened during the night? At the goat?
Oh my god. So, during the night, the twins and Thompson are locked up in the goat pen, and they hear this loud thud hit the top of the pen. And then something slides off the top of the pen and starts walking around. Well, while that's happening outside, inside, the mom and dad are asleep. William and Catherine are asleep. And then Catherine notices that Caleb and Samuel are sitting in a chair. And she's just so happy and excited. She goes and, you know, up to her two children that she thought she had lost. And I want to say Caleb tells her that they have a carriage or they have something for her.
It's
and
a
he's
book.
Whispering
a
this. He's a really
book.
Talking.
They want
a book. Okay. That's
yeah, they want the mother to sign the book.
Well, I know she was like, I guess because she agrees to sign it, but she's like, but first, someone's hungry. Because Samuel starts to kind of whine. So she undoes her little blouse and goes to feed him. Well, while she's feeding Samuel, shit's going down outside. That's when something comes crashing into the pen with the kids. Now, Thomason's actually asleep, but the twins are still awake and they hear it. So as the witch comes crashing through the goat pen, the twins start screaming, and it wakes Thomason up, and she realizes what's happened, she starts to scream. And as that's happening, they go back to the mother, who you think's feeding her child, but it's actually a fucking crow picking at her nipple, eating the flesh off her nipple.
Yep.
Fun stuff, everybody. That's a party for our night.
But before, let's go back a little bit. So let's go back to the goat pen. And before Thompson and the twins actually scream, they notice the naked old lady is, like, doing something with the white goat.
I think she's eating it. That's right. I think she's eating the goat or something.
I think she's, like, drinking the, quote-unquote, like, goat blood or something, like, that got spilt in the bucket or something.
It was just weird.
Yeah.
She was, like, crouched there.
Yes. But, hon, you were gonna say something? You were kind of saying something? Am I right? No? Okay.
Who? Me? No.
Tessa. No, Tessa. I meant.
Oh.
I think Tessa was going to say something, but I don't think she is.
You guys already said it.
Okay. She was going to say something, though. But, yeah. So, yeah. All that shit goes down. So, pretty much, it's like a dream. Like a bad fucking vision of the mother thinking the two kids that she just lost are still alive. And, I don't know, I just felt like that was a cool scene, but I also feel like, shouldn't the mother have realized she, like, the two kids are actually dead? And
I think she was just in such a delusional state from exhaustion, because she hadn't been sleeping.
Yeah, she hadn't been sleeping.
At all, but I think it just messed with her mind, and she was just unraveling mentally.
Which... You guys probably noticed this too, but when Caleb was talking to the mother in the delusional vision, when he was talking, he was actually whispering. I don't know if you guys...
Yeah, he was whispering. He wasn't really speaking to her.
No, but he had, like, that dark voice, too.
He had, like, a dark whisper, like, kind of like, I don't want to give too much away because it kind of, we're not there yet, but who he kind of sounds like or is portraying, more or less.
Yeah.
I don't want to reveal too much yet.
Yeah, it's pretty much that figure, though. It's pretty much that figure trying to get the mother to sign the book, which I found was kind of interesting. That he was even trying to go after the mother to sign the book, which, I guess to him, she refused it. And that's why the crow or raven was pretty much pecking at the nipple. So the next day, when William finally wakes up, and, you know, Catherine is even, awake, too, and you definitely see the bloody area where the raven or crow had been pecking. And then William finally gets outside, and then he looks over at the goat bin and just stares. And he walks over a little bit more. And then that's when you see the goats have been skinned and, killed.
Dismembered.
The twins are now missing. The bin itself is just destroyed. It is just completely, not what it was. Pretty much like a tornado went through within the night. But it only took out the goat bin. At this point in time, William was trying to do, I think about to say something to Thomasine, because Thomasine is finally kind of waking up. And then Thomasine sees William get hit, rammed by Black Phillip, the goat. Fintailed by the horns. And then, once again, I should back up for a minute. Before all this, during the night when the twins and Thomasine were in the goat bin, and this is during the nighttime when it was raining still, William was outside cutting wood, and then he stopped, and he confessed that it must be his fault, and that to do away with him as you please, pretty much, is what he's saying. He just pretty much has kind of given up. He just wants to just be ended, and he doesn't care how. So I think when Black Phillip finally rams William, I think in this point in time, when he's trying to grab the axe again, or the wood splitter, the wood axe, I think he finally realizes, this is his demise. This is what he gets from asking to do with him as you please kind of thing. So then,
you got what you asked for.
Pretty much. Which, Krista, what did you think of this part when William died by getting knocked for the second time to hit the pile of chopped wood to tumble upon him before, Black Phil walks away after he noticed that William is dead?
I was kind of shocked, because, I know when they showed the pin with the goats, you didn't see Black Phillip's body, so I didn't know where he had went. And I remember, I think Kim and Thomasine are arguing or something, I think right before he gets stuck, if I'm not mistaken. Because I know Thomasine's getting up out of the pen. She's starting to wake up. And I think he's talking to her. And next thing I know, Black Phillip just turns his head to the side and goes, jam, right into the kidney.
Yep.
And I was like, oh, man. Are you serious? And of course they tussle for a minute, and then when Black Phillip rams him into the wood pile and just spills all the wood on him, I was like, this poor bastard, he just had the shittiest luck. He did ask for it, though, like Tessa said, be careful what you wish for, because you might just get it. And he got what he asked for. I don't know if that's how he wanted to go, but he got what he wanted. And then, you know, Black Phillip's like, hey, I'm a goat. I'm going to go do goat stuff.
yeah, something like that. So then at this point in time, Catherine then comes out. Oh, boy. Who wants to tell the story of Catherine?
Oh, Lord.
Does Krista want to continue this story?
I can.
All right, Krista, well, since you're the new co-host, you might as well.
Well, another co-host. Not my replacement.
He's not your replacement, but it is.
Oh, of course. I hope not.
Yeah, definitely not, but she's our other co-host. But anyways, go on, hon.
So, Catherine comes out, and if you thought William had lost his shit, she has. Like, there, you can just see in her face that there's just nothing left in her. Like, she's gone deranged. You know, she starts yelling at Thomas and, you know, telling her this is your fault. You know, they start to fight. She actually starts beating on Thomason as Thomason's trying to, like, explain to her and calm her down. And at one point...
Oh, God. We forgot the fire.
Fire! Fire!
Our smoke alarm's just really sensitive.
Yeah, it is very well sensitive. So sorry for anybody's ear for that, like, 2 seconds.
There's actually one point where Catherine puts her head against Thomas and, like, you know, just in grief. And then she just starts wailing on her. And gets her onto the ground, and she's still fighting with Thomas. And Thomas ends up grabbing a knife that's on the ground.
Hook. It's a bill hook.
It's a what? Oh, a bill hook.
Grabs it. I'm going to pause it for right there for a second. But yeah, Kat, I was going to say this before the fire alarm went off. But Catherine was yelling at Thomasine because she is now blaming Thomasine for the twins being gone now and killing
Caleb and William, taking them away from her, like essentially everything.
Pretty much, yeah. She pretty much now thinks that it's because of Thomasine. Thomasine is now the witch. Because she's taken out Sam at first, because she was the last one to see Sam. Caleb, because, you know, they thought she'd be with them. Then the twins are gone, which, that's another freaking theory that we can all say, which we probably couldn't know what probably happened. But, yeah, so, and then the last one is William, her husband. But, please continue, Crystal. So, yeah, she gets...
I know at one point...
Yeah, she gets the bell
hook. Well, I know at one... Yeah, she gets the bell hook and hits him with it. But I was going to say, at one point, when she is blaming Thomason for the murder, she's trying to deny it, and she says, how can you deny it? Their blood are on your hands.
Yes. Because the blood came from the goat bin somewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, while she's got the bill hook, she hits the mother the first time, and, like, it shocks the both of them, because, like, I guess Thompson went to do it out of reaction, you know, fight or flight. She hit her out of, you know, just defense, protect herself, and then her mother's looking at her with this big old cut across her face, and like she's just staring at her. And then the blood just starts pouring down, and I think she yells, and she starts trying to attack her some more.
She's trying to strangle
her. Poor Thomas. Yeah, she tries to strangle her, and while she's strangling her, Thomas starts slicing her over and over again with the bell hook until she finally kills her mother. And her mother just slumps over on top of her. And, Thomas, you know, lays there for a minute crying. And she finally pushes her mother off of her. And she ends up going back to the house, taking off her bloody clothes. And, well, first she puts, I think, Black Phillip back into the pen. She makes sure he's back in the pen. And then she goes back in the house, and she undresses, puts a blanket on herself, and just falls asleep for a little while, takes a nap. You know, after all that, it's time to take a nap. You know, so she falls asleep and stays asleep until nightfall, and something wakes her up, and she ends up going back to the goat pen to Black Phillip.
Yeah, it's almost like Black Phillip was, like, almost calling her to wake up.
Calling her.
Yeah.
So there's a jingling noise.
Yeah. She goes, I conjure thee to speak to me as you did the twins.
Yep.
And at first, I guess she realizes she's going crazy because, okay, he's not saying anything. So she goes to turn around, and that's when Black Phillip asks what she wants of him. And it's just that ominous whispering voice, which I'm sure you can often tell who Black Phillip actually is. Well, so he asks her, you know, do you want to stay young? Do you want to see the world? Do you want to travel?
Do you want a pretty dress? And she says,
yes.
Pretty
do you want to live deliciously? Dress.
And of course, she agrees to all this.
Signed the book.
And so you sign the book. She's like, I don't know how to write. And at this point in time, Black Phillip is no longer a goat. He is this man that you really don't see. He's more of a silhouette. But he comes up by her real sensual, like, and whispers her, you know, gets close to him, goes, you know, I will help you write your name.
Which?
I will guide your hand.
Yeah, I will guide your hand. And then we'll have this part be for Tessa, just because this would be her type of talk anyway. But, before we go into that, though, I just wanted to state, after watching the question and answering on the DVD, we found out that costume for Satan, a.k.a. Black Phillip, when he, the handsomely man, as Robert Eggers said, what I find really funny is that Satan, the guy who playing Satan, or is what the most expensive costume of the movie, and you don't even see the costume. Like, you can't even see
him.
Oh,
man.
Like, you can see him, but not as great, though, which I found to be interesting. Which, Chrystello, you did happen to notice him walking behind Thomasine, right? Like, could you...
I did. He was, like, circling earlier. From what I could tell of him, he had, like, a mustache, and, it looked like, wouldn't say a pilgrim hat. But he had, like, some fancy little hat on.
Yeah, it's a fancy hat, and it has a special name in them.
Like a cavalier.
Yeah, like a cavalier.
But that's almost all you can really see of him. There's not much of him you can actually see.
Yeah, like Crystal and Paul say, you really don't get to see Satan, how he's depicted in this film. And Paul and I saw what his costume actually looks like in the Q&A, and we were like, holy shit, we wish we could have seen that in the film, because it was gorgeous.
Yeah.
For a man costume, it was gorgeous.
Yes.
Anyways, all you really get to see of Satan in this movie in his, we'll just say, human form, for lack of a better term, is his boot with the spurs, his silhouette walking around behind Thomasin. You see, like, bits of his face here and there, his hand upon her shoulder after he tells her to disrobe, to strip down, skyclad, which is naked, for those of you that don't know what skyclad means. And like Chrystello says, he helps her sign the book, I'll guide your hand. And then after this, you see Thomasin walking out towards the tree line with a full moon up in the sky, walking out to the tree line of the woods, starts walking into the woods with Black Phillip, a.k.a. Satan, back in goat form, following her. and he's leading her through the woods, and you get to this almost kind of clearing in the middle of the woods where there's a bonfire, and you see, I don't know, like 20 or so women naked dancing and chanting and, you know, like moving around this fire, and you see Black Phillip up by the bonfire with all these naked women, presumably other witches, and he's kind of looking at Thomason because she stops and she's watching, and he kind of looks over at her like it's okay, come on, you know, join. And she eventually goes over, and they all start laughing. And as they start laughing, they start levitating, like flying up into the air. And you start to notice Thomason, she's starting to float too, and she starts laughing. And she really gets into it, and she's really laughing. And I'm assuming that it's her that's up in the air that it shows us.
Above the trees,
above
yeah.
the trees, I'm assuming it is her. But all of these witches are levitating up in the air, and that's where the movie stops. Or ends, essentially.
Yep. That pretty much was the end of the film, when you just see Thomasine levitating up above the trees. But, so Crystal, for somebody who hasn't seen it, since you saw it the first time last night, what are your thoughts on it?
It's really good. It's a beautifully done film. Like I said, the music score, the acting, it really puts you into that time frame and that era, and you really get involved. But it's a really fucked up movie. It really is. If you see all the little details of what they're playing at, it's really fucked up, especially with incest and all that. The nipple biting of the crow, I'm just like, all right, hey. But it's a beautifully done. I'm glad you told me to watch it. I recommend it. I mean, I don't watch many witch films, but for a film that depicts 1600s in such a way that it's believable. I mean, I haven't seen movies besides like documentaries that pull this kind of stuff off to where you can actually say, all right, yeah, this is something I could believe. So I it's really good.
I'm going to mention something, too. As Paul and I, we were watching the Q&A last night with the director and Anya, who played as Thomason, and the historians. He even mentioned that this movie was not meant to reflect like Wiccans or contemporary witches. It was meant to show, like, or the white witches. It was meant to, like, depict the darker side of witchcraft, not necessarily the good. It was reflecting upon the evil.
The black magic.
The black magic aspect.
Which, if people don't know, there are good and bad witches out there. I can tell you that. You got your good witches, and you got your witches that practice black magic, which clearly this is black magic in this film. But it also depicts the paranoia of that time. I mean, how the kids were, you know, acting like they were being bewitched and all that. That is what actually happened at the Salem witch trials. You know, people were pretending to be bewitched and get innocent people hung or burnt to the stake for claiming to be witches or drowned. So that's actually something that actually happened back in the day. Children, girls would do that. They would pretend to be bewitched and say they don't remember their prayers or fall to the ground in a seizure and then blame it on them and saying they did it, they're a witch, and you can't defend yourself, so you get killed.
Which, since we're on the subject on, like, witches, I just need to point this show out because it's an amazing show. But you guys, I know we've seen it, Tessa, but Chrystello, have you seen Salem, the TV show, Salem?
I have not.
Oh, my God.
I have not seen Salem.
What?
Oh, my God, you need to watch it.
You need to watch it. You need to watch it, then.
I keep hearing it's really good.
It's so good.
But...
And the main theme song for Salem...
Pound me the witch drum.
...is Cupid the Carries a Gum by Marilyn Manson.
Hallelujah.
Oh, that's so awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Leave it to Marilyn Manson to do it too, boy. I love me some Marilyn Manson.
Which I believe I actually played that theme song on the Sound of Horror episode, I believe, too.
Mm-hmm. Yep, you sure did.
I think you did.
Yeah, according to a test that I did, which I believe I'm pretty sure I did.
Because I listened to it recently. I listened to that podcast recently.
I didn't want to miss that one either, just because it's a good show. Three seasons, I think. Three or four. I think we're waiting on the fourth one. I'm trying to remember now. Which we need to look that up after this podcast. But the reason why I bring up that show, though, I know The Witch... The film that we were just talking about is not taking place around Salem, but like what you were saying, Chrystello, about the Salem witch trial. The TV show Salem does a phenomenal job about what you're saying about kids trying to pretend being bewitching and like blaming their parents or their neighbors or somebody. I mean. That's just what the show is, because at one of the episodes, you get to see these people who have the person who is supposedly being, what's that word I'm looking for? Supposedly having like a bewitch episode, we'll say, but she's in just like a leash thing, and she's going around town, and when she sees the person who's supposedly bewitched her, they're supposed to, like, point at the witch, so that the witch can get put to trial kind of thing. So, that's why I wanted to bring that up, since you mentioned Salem.
I believe her name in Salem as well was Mercy.
I believe you're right. I believe you're right. But one awesome thing about the Salem show, though, is that Salem is actually has names taken from real records. So, like, the names in the show you see are actually real people back in the day that have been recorded. Or, like, either witchery or whatever. Which is awesome.
That's cool.
Which is awesome, but this is after Bridget Bishop, too. Because they do bring her name up. And those of you that do not know, but Bridget Bishop was the first witch to be hanged in Salem. But,
so, like, when I say about the girls pretending to be bewitched, those, that's where it all started from. There was actually girls at her trial saying that she was bewitching them at her own trial.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great show, just like it was a phenomenal movie, which brings to something I wanted to talk about, which I did kind of mention in one episode. I don't remember which episode right now, so it's Chrystello or Tessa, if you remember what episode that I talk about it, but it's, I think it's actually in What the Fuck Horror, now that I really think about it, but, this is one of the movies, though, where people went to see it to get scared. They weren't in it for the story, they just wanted to get scared. So, I don't know, like, it kind of like, what I asked you guys the other night, like, how do you guys feel about PG-13 to rated R film for horror? It's kind of like this saying, like, you think they would rather go to, like, what would I say, like, paranormal over The Witch, because The Witch seemed more historical Western, rather than a movie that makes you get jump scared the crap out of. So it kind of makes me feel like that, because I mean, I remember when The Witch came out, I saw it. I even went on the Facebook page of The Witch, and I'm just like, look, if you're looking to get scared, go watch some other piece of shit film. If you're looking for a story about a real struggling family type deal, then where you get to learn about witches, this is the film for you. I pretty much even said, like, if you're looking to get scared, don't bother. Because, like, it's not that type of scary. Like, it is, but it isn't. Like, if you're looking for jump scares, don't bother. Because there's really no jump scares in The Witch. But, yeah. Let's see here. So, as you, Chester was kind of saying earlier about the whole, like, the witch's familiars. In this movie, you definitely notice the rabbit at first. You notice Black Phillip, secondly, the black goat. And then you notice the raven. Which, in this case, the rabbit and the raven or crow. I want to say raven, but, those must have been the witch's familiars. Possibly, but then now more that I think about it, I wonder if the raven was more toward Satan, with aka Black Phillip, just because his voice was definitely there when he was talking as Caleb, trying to trick the mother into signing the book. Which I guess I could ask you guys this, so. Now that you guys know what the book was, which is pretty much what Thomasine signed.
It was a contract.
The contract. Now, let me ask you this. Do you think Satan wanted her to sign it because she'd been through, or because of her losses, so it would make her feel like, even though she'd lost everything, she still could live like a delicious life and can travel the world with a pretty dress?
Are we talking about Thomason? Are you talking about Catherine?
Catherine.
I think he more or less.
Like it's Catherine were to sign, would have signed the book rather than saying, hang on a minute, the baby's hungry.
I think that, he wanted her to. I think he wanted to wear her down enough, weaken her resolve, and to the point where. It turned her away from God.
Which it kind of did.
Because yeah, it did. And what I'm saying is, I think he ultimately wanted her to sign the book as, like, an ultimate, like, ha-ha, like, to God. Like, you lost.
Yeah. Like, I just converted one of your guys over to me kind of thing.
Yeah.
But, Crypto, do you have any thoughts on that? Like, if Catherine were to sign the book, was there anything added besides what Catherine was saying, or do you kind of agree with her?
No, I pretty much agree with her, but the thing about the raven or the crow, I mean, whatever, whichever one you want to call it, I think it was more of a punishment in a way, like, because she didn't sign the book, she chose to feed the baby instead, and
she defied him.
Yes.
Yeah, she defied him.
And that was her punishment for it. That's how I looked at it.
Yeah, because, I mean, alright, I need to say this real quick, too, because I wrote this down. I really actually kind of, what annoyed me the most about this movie, especially for someone like me with a hearing problem, the whispering in a theater, I hate. I hate whisperers in a movie, because for someone like me, I gotta have subtitles on for whispering, because otherwise I can't really hear what's being said. Kind of like when Satan is talking to Thomasine near the end. Like, I could make out bits and pieces of what he was saying. Like, I heard something, like, I remembered hearing him saying something about, sign the book, and I'll guide your hand. But other than that, like, the whole travel the world, to live deliciously, and wear a pretty dress, I actually didn't know he said that until after the DVD came out, when I could actually rewatch the film in with subtitles. But, yeah, I just wanted to throw that out there real quick. But no, so back to Catherine about not signing the book and stuff, and like what Tessa was saying about losing faith, which she did, because when Caleb died, Catherine was mentioning to William about a confession about a dream she once had with the Lord, how she felt so close to the Lord.
She felt such a profound, passionate love for it, for the Lord. And how she,
missed being in England.
Yeah, how she missed being in England, and how complete she felt when Sam was here. And she thought, well, I thought I could feel, I have a confession to make. I've been bitter towards you. I've been shrewd to you. I haven't shown you love as a wife should to a husband. And,
well, that kind of falls under, like, her not showing love to the kids even, especially Thomasine.
Well, I have my thoughts about that, honestly. I think that almost throughout the entire movie, Catherine resented Thomasine in a way. Like, she had such a resentment towards her, and she just, like, snubbed her ever since the situation with Sam being lost or taken. And, you know, just how things just kept going. Like, it's almost she wanted to blame her at every turn. Like, she blamed her for Sam. She blamed her for the cup. She blamed her for Caleb. She blamed her for William. She blamed her for the twins. Like, she blamed her for everything that she could possibly blame her for. Like, you know, she just had, like, this deep-seated resentment towards Thomasine. She just pretty much had it out for her almost the entire film, except for, like one moment where she's just, like, where Thomasine's just pretty much begging her, you know, like, let me find favor in your eyes. You know, she's, like, Thomasine just wants so much for just once, just for her mother just to just love her, just be a mother to her. Instead of treating her like a slave.
And believe her, too.
Yeah, and believe her because when she says stuff. Neither one of her parents really believed her. Like when William was, you know, saying, you know, confess. You know, speak truth from thy lips. You know, let me hear truth from you. And, you know, Thomasine was telling him the truth. And no matter how much she tried to tell him the truth, he wouldn't believe her. And, you know, that's another thing that I noticed. Neither one of her parents believed her. Like, they questioned her. And they were the ones that were lying. Like, they're the ones that had secrets and confessions, and they lied about things. And Thomasine was actually honest. You know?
I do have, like, a theory about Thomasine, just the way her mother acted towards her. Like, I thought about it, and I'm like, I mean, it could possibly happen, yeah. But I don't think Thomasine was Catherine's daughter. I really think that maybe it's William's daughter, but maybe William's had a previous wife who passed, and, you know, Samuel and the twins, and Caleb were their children, but I like, this, the way she treated Thomasine, I don't think Thomasine was her actual daughter. the other kids may have been her children, because she, like, had a real fondness for Caleb and the twins and for Sam, but she just, like you said, she had this utter resentment for Thomas, and no matter what she did, even before stuff started happening, they just didn't have a bond. And I'm thinking, could she not be Catherine's daughter? And maybe, like, a child from a previous mother that passed away or something happened, and, you know, it's William's daughter, but it's not hers. That's how I looked at it. Like, that was my viewpoint of why she treated her so badly. I could be wrong, but It's just, there was no mother-daughter connection in that film whatsoever.
No.
And that's what I thought. Maybe it's not her kid. Maybe it's like a stepdaughter or something. That's why Thompson tells her, you know, let me gain favor in your eyes. Because she's never had it before.
That's a good theory, too. But one thing I did notice with this film is that you never learn their last name either, which is kind of fine, but when I was trying to write this note at first, when I got to the very first part about the judge banishing the family, as soon as I got to the part in the note about the family, I was trying to remember what their last name was, and then I was like, wait a minute. So I looked it up on IMDb, and I was just like, oh yeah, they didn't have a last name. Which, I guess they've gotten away with it just because, I mean, I guess they didn't really need a last name because they weren't really portraying a real family, but
real characters.
Yeah, real characters. But I think note-wise, this would have been easier for me, but otherwise, that's not really too much of a big complaint. But I just felt like it was weird that you didn't really have a last name for this family.
You know, I never realized I didn't have a last name.
Yeah, they didn't have a last name. Like, you never heard a name, last name from them. And when you go to look it up, there's no last name. So, I don't know.
Forever be a mystery.
Yep, forever a mystery. Which, if they did show last names, it would have maybe proved the point of what you were saying about Thomasine not being their actual daughter. Or, well, Catherine's daughter or something. Maybe it was William's daughter, but I guess we'll never know. But, yeah, so does anybody else have anything real quick about the witch that we didn't maybe go over that you guys kind of noticed in the movie? That's shaking her head.
No, I think I pretty much mentioned everything I wanted to.
Yeah?
Yeah.
We were pretty thorough about it. I don't think we missed anything.
I guess my little question now would be, before we end this, is, would you guys recommend this movie to your friends or family or whatever in general?
Yeah, I would. I would recommend it. It's actually really good. I was surprised actually how much I did like it. And the soundtrack is just phenomenal, and it just draws you in and sucks you in. You're just like, oh. But don't do like Crystal did and get up and, like, walk out of the room during it, pause the movie.
Like we did last night.
Like we did last night. When we got up to do stuff, we paused the movie and we got up and did whatever and came back.
Unless I knew the part and then went in this craze. Bad, Crystal. Bad.
Hey, in my defense, my kitchen connects to my living room. I just had my back turned. That's all.
Nah.
I can still hear it. I just didn't see it.
You just didn't see Caleb naked in the rain when he was delusional and stuff.
I didn't.
But I guess.
But now I know how they found him.
Yeah, exactly. Now you know how he was found. But, so, at the last question for you guys, what would you guys rate the film One out of five. Five being the best, one being the worst. What would you guys rate it as?
Five plus, for sure.
Five plus?
I'd definitely give it a five.
Yeah, I mean, I would give it, like, a five plus, like what you were saying. I just felt the movie was awesome. But on that note...
Co-host,
Tessa Baker. And I'm your host, Paul Dolce.
And I'm one of the
co-hosts. That's right. Congratulations to Chrystello for being the new co-host. Woo! Well, one of the new co-hosts, I should say. We don't want to replace Tessa here.
Okay, she's like my co-pilot.
Yeah. She's like a co-assistant.
She's like my co-assistant.
I am the coolest.
Yes. But okay, guys, let's try this on the count of three. Ready? We'll say stay scary as count of three. Ready? Everybody, one, two, three, stay scary.